What's up everyone, I'm Kyle, and in today's video I'm going to be revealing all of the secrets and specifications of the newly redesigned Robot Inventor Motors. You're not going to want to miss this, so don't go anywhere. How's it going everyone? It's Kyle here again, broadcasting to all of you at home in the BuilderDude 35 nation. If you remember my unboxing and review video of the new Robot Inventor, I'll put the link up here. You've heard my opinions on the Robot Inventor and heard me talk a little bit about these newly redesigned motors. However, today's video is going to be special because I'm going to be doing a deep dive and talking about all of the details, the gory technical specifications of these new motors, and let you know everything you need to know. In a lot of places, I'm going to be using the EV3 motors as a benchmark for a comparison with these new motors. If you're a longtime subscriber to my channel, that's probably what's most familiar to you. And if you're new to this channel, hey, how's it going? I encourage you to subscribe to the channel because I do this every single week and it's great to have you here. I'm going to evaluate these new motors using what I call the FAST method. FAST is an acronym for the four most important metrics we want to look at when we're evaluating a motor, and it stands for form factor, accuracy, speed, and torque. Now it's worth mentioning that these Robot Inventor motors are mechanically identical to the media motors that came out with LEGO Spike Prime. Nothing wrong with that, just worth noting. So first things first, I want to talk about the exterior features or the form factor of this motor. This is a side exit motor. Some people also know these as angular motors. What that means is that the motor's power is routed out of the side of the motor. This means it is functionally most similar to the EV3 large motor. Both of these are side exit motors, so power goes out of the side of the motor, and this makes it really easy to build a simple robotic drivetrain for your robot. So this is one of those motors right here, and then you can have the power directly exit out the side of the motor to power a wheel. On one side, there is a light gray glide wheel, which gives you a whole bunch of mounting options. This is similar to the red glide wheels that were on the EV3 large motor. And on the other side, we get just a simple axle port. This is similar to the axle port on the EV3 medium motor. One thing you'll notice in comparison is how much smaller the Robot Inventor motor is compared to the EV3 large motor. And this is really great. I always felt that these motors were kind of large and cumbersome, to incorporate into your robots, but these are much smaller, more streamlined. However, that might imply that they have less torque and less mechanical power, which I'll be discussing later in the video. Even though they're mechanically similar to the large motors, they're actually pretty similar in size and dimensions to the EV3 medium motor. One other really great exterior feature to note is if you look at the motor, there are pinholes everywhere, which means there are tons of mounting options for this motor, which is just another thing that makes using this motor an absolute breeze in your robotics projects. If you're gonna use this motor in a use case where you're inserting a Technic axle into the crosshole on either side of the motor, it's worth noting that there is a mechanical stopper on both sides of the motor at a stud depth of 1 stud. So if you try to take a Technic axle and insert it into the crosshole on either side of the motor, it will stop at a depth of 1 stud in. Now this is, you know, pretty great because it prevents you from taking a really short Technic axle, so think of 3 studs or 2 studs, and inserting it and then just completely getting it stuck in the motor, which is kind of a really nice touch in my opinion. Printed on the front of the motor, you'll notice a little dark gray indicator. This indicator is important because it denotes the zero position, so the 0 degree mark on this motor's encoder. And unlike the EV3 motors of past, the new Robot Inventor motors have absolute motor encoders, which means that no matter how you turn on this motor, no matter what position the glide wheel is on when the motor turns on, this will always recognize this position where the indicator is lined up as 0 degrees, always, no matter what. And the motor encoder always measures motor position relative to this zero position that is printed on the motor's chassis. So that means starting here, it will always recognize this is 0 degrees, and you can turn it and the degree value will keep increasing or decreasing away from zero until you get back around. It'll go to 359 degrees. And then once you get back to this point again where the indicators line up, it will see this as 0 degrees and it starts all over again. This is different from the EV3 motors because wherever the EV3 motors were when they turned on, it would call that the 0 degree position, and you could keep turning and turning the motors. So if you turned it all the way one rotation, it would go 359, then 360, then 361 degrees, and it would keep counting after that. Whereas these motors reset once you go all the way around one rotation back to 0. Zero. That's gonna make using these motors a little bit different from what we're used to in the past, but expect to see another video soon, which will be a deep dive into how to make the most of these new style motor encoders. Let's talk about the accuracy of the new motors. What I did is I used a high Technic angle sensor. This is a sensor that's compatible with either an NXT or an EV3, and it can measure both angle in degrees or rotation speed in revolutions per minute, or RPM. I took a Technic axle directly out of that motor and into the front of the high Technic angle sensor, programmed the motor to spin one rotation at maximum power 10 times in a row. And what I did is then I read the angle displacement off of the angle sensor relative to where it started. So ideally, a motor that's perfectly accurate will have an offset of 0 degrees at the end. Of course, I tried this for 10 trials and I took the average over the course of those 10 trials. After my accuracy test, I discovered that the Robot Inventor motors had on average 0.8 degrees of offset relative to its original position. So it's less than a degree. That's pretty good. The EV3 large motors, for comparison, had on average 0.3 degrees of offset, which is quite a bit less than the Robot Inventor motors. The EV3 medium motors, again for comparison, had on average 2.3 degrees of offset at the end of the test. So to summarize the accuracy test, the Robot Inventor motors are in the same ballpark as what we're used to using with the EV3 large motors, if they're maybe a little bit less accurate, and the EV3 medium motors are definitely the less accurate of the three. How fast do these motors spin? Let's talk about rotation speed. So to measure the maximum rotation speed of the motors, I programmed the motor to run forward at 100% power, and then I made a script on the EV3 that would display the rotation speed measured by the angle sensor in RPM on the EV3 screen. With all of that set up, I noticed that the new Robot Inventor motors spun between 155 and 160 RPM at max rotation speed. This is actually almost the same as the EV3 large motors, which also spun at 155 to 160. 60 RPM. Just for kicks, I also tried the EV3 medium motor, and that spun at 220 revolutions per minute, or RPM. It's worth noting that the motors were on different power supplies. So the Robot Inventor motor was running on the included 7.3 volt battery pack that comes with the Robot Inventor set, and the EV3 motors were running on a 10 volt rechargeable battery supply that came with the EV3 set. I know the voltage makes a big difference in the motor's rotation speed, and a higher voltage will make a motor run faster. But in my opinion, the most fair way to test this is to use the battery packs that come with each of these sets. So all of the people who use the Robot Inventor will use the Robot Inventor battery pack at 7.3 volts. The people who use the EV3 will use the EV3 battery pack at 10 volts. So even though the voltages are not exactly the same, I felt like this was the most fair comparison because this is the way people are most likely going to power their motors. Another important metric to discuss when we're talking about motors is torque. Now, torque is force applied across a radius. So the amount of rotating force a motor can apply, and it's measured in Newton centimeters. Now, to be honest, I don't have the equipment necessary to measure torque myself, so I looked it up on a reliable source. So that's Philo Herbain's website. I'll put the link in the description down below. Thank you, Philo, for your hard work. The first number I'm going to quote to you is stall torque, which is the amount of torque in Newton centimeters that you need to stop the motor completely while it is running. The Robot Inventor motors have 13.5 Newton centimeters of stall torque, which is quite a bit less than the EV3 large motors, which have a whopping 43 Newton centimeters of stall torque. In this case, the Robot Inventor motors are actually closer to the EV3 medium motors. The next set of numbers is running torque, also measured in Newton centimeters. This is the amount of torque that the motor applies when it is turning. The Robot Inventor motors had 4.5 Newton centimeters of torque, which is still less than the approximately 17 Newton centimeters of running torque that the EV3 large motors have. Again, in this scenario, the Robot Inventor motors are more similar to the EV3 medium motors, and the medium motors had 6.6 Newton centimeters of running torque. And just to clarify a question that might come up, you always expect stall torque to be greater than running torque for the same given motor, and that's just because it takes more torque to stop the motor in its tracks than the motor applies when it is running. That just has to do with the electrical properties of an electric motor. So when you apply resistance to an electric motor, it draws more current from its power supply, which allows it to produce more torque. The reason why torque is such an important number to consider is because, as I mentioned before, it's a measure of the twisting force a motor can apply. And it's really important anytime you need to move something heavy. and especially for the drive motors of a robot. The drive motors are responsible for moving the entire rest of the robot, and any motor you choose as a drive motor needs to have enough torque to be able to move all of the robot's weight. Now, knowing what we do about the torque figures for each of these motors, it's useful to keep in mind that the EV3 large motors were always way more torquey than you needed them to be. So the robot inventor motors for most drive motor applications will probably be just fine for most robots, as long as your robot's not excessively heavy. The limitation you might run into, though, is if you try to put really tall wheels on your robot or put a gear ratio that gears the motor's output RPM to be higher externally, you might run into some problems where your robot doesn't have enough torque where you might have been able to do it before with an EV3 large motor. So just something to keep in mind if you're experimenting with tall wheels or really fancy gear trains. I hope you learned everything you needed to know about these new robot inventor motors. If you really enjoyed diving into the nerdy statistics and figures, I hope you'll leave a like down below and subscribe to the channel, because I do videos like this every single week and you're not going to want to miss the rest of them. Anyway, thanks so much for watching, and I'll see you in the next video.